Welcome to online worship from the Two Rivers Benefice, and thank you for joining us. All the words for the service will be shown on the screen, and the words that we say together will be shown in yellow type. And now our opening prayer. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never.
The sun comes up.
The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Yeah.
yes, I will worship your holy name.
Let's now take a few moments to say sorry to God for all the wrong things we do, think, and say. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As sisters and brothers in God's family, we come together to ask our Father for forgiveness. You made us to be one family, yet we have divided humanity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You were born a Jew to reconcile all people, yet we have brought disharmony among races. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You rejoice in our differences, yet we make them a cause of enmity. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And so may God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
This is the 6-beat, 6-piece scripture story. This is the overarching rescue plan story. This is part 4 of the better story. Where is the love that Israel longs for from the Lord? 400 years past, it feels like he's on airplane mode. Their home, but somehow still exiles. The Romans knocked the door and invited themselves inside. What's the meaning of it all? And what about freedom? How can you know peace when you're ruled by another kingdom? The game-changing moment arrives, meaning the magnificent maker who makes everything wrapped in linen cloths, had beauty spots, earlobes and skin, worshipped by shepherds in gifts fit for a king. Jesus grows up, gets baptized by John, the world's sin he erases. John says, "I'm not even fit to tie up his laces." And Jesus faces wilderness and he overcomes it, preaches Isaiah and says, "I've come to fulfill it," eats meals with the marginalized, dinner with outcasts, healed abseiling paralytics who picked up their own mats. Jesus raised up Lazarus, though he lay in a casket. He fed a stadium full with just one picnic basket. Then to Jerusalem, riding a donkey, passed over palm leaves, Hosanna in harmony, and pass over to Gethsemane and the blood-soaked prayer sweats, to Jesus in handcuffs as he gets arrested, to denial, to mock trial, to beating to Pilate, who's swayed by the riots and crucifixion demands, sees perfection but keeps quiet and just washes his hands, to the cross. Jesus battered, body teared like flatbread, blood poured out like a cup of red. They erected the Saviour to showcase his suffering. "Forgive them, Lord," he said. "They just don't know what they are doing." With one final cry out, sin's curse is extinguished as love laid out his hands. He said, "It is finished." Is this how it finished? Is this it? Wrapped in burial cloths, they sign the death certificate. This may be the final chapter, but there's a sequel to the story, because on the third day, he resurrects to glory, death defeated by the one we call holy. So love surely lives. Yes, the risen one gives a love that no other love compares with. This is the day. This is the day that the game changed, hope reclaimed, victory over death proclaimed as the Messiah's stone rolled away. Because love resurrected on Resurrection Sunday.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased." The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There, they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. while they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." When he had led them out of the vicinity of Bethany, Jesus lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy.
Down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. powerful to me. Oh Lord, you are so worthy, and Lord, you are so wonderful to me.
The Beatles famously sang, "Love is all you need." And they weren't wrong. Physically, we need food and water and shelter, but emotionally, we need to be loved and to love in order to thrive. That's why rejection hurts so much. Perhaps you've had your heart broken. Sometimes we respond by closing down and becoming hardened. Other times we chase approval, desperate to feel loved again. But behind it all is a question. Who is the source of true love? Well, the Bible is one long love story that redirects our desire back to its source. As we enter the New Testament, we discover a perfect love has come looking for us. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. Jesus Christ is God's love in person, perfect love in action, the broken healed, the guilty forgiven, the marginalized welcomed home. So who is this Messiah, and how can we experience his perfect love?
Firstly, Messiah is the good king.
Now, the word Messiah means anointed one, because in Israel, kings were anointed with oil as a sign of God's authority. Now, the Greek equivalent of Messiah is Christos. So Christ is not Jesus' surname, it's his title, Jesus, the anointed one, the king. He's not just a nice guy or a wise old sage. He's the long-awaited serpent crusher. As Jesus declared at the start of his public ministry, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news. Now, why is the arrival of the king such good news? Perhaps you're familiar with Disney's film, The Lion King. It echoes the Bible's plotline. When the rightful Lion King, Simba, gets evicted from his homeland by evil Uncle Scar, the fertile plains become a dust bowl and the animals begin to starve. But the turning point comes when Simba returns from exile to lay claim to the throne. All the animals know what's at stake. If the kingdom is to flourish again, the good king must rule. Needless to say, after a scary fight with a gang of hyenas, Simba's made king and the land flourishes once more. The arrival of the Messiah is the good king coming to end our exile. Through Jesus, ordinary people like you and me can be transformed by the power of God's love. And the Messiah is not just for religious types, far from it. Jesus was a friend of Mary Magdalene, whose life was complex and broken, but he transformed her by the beauty of his love. He was a friend of Zacchaeus, who was a greedy little tax collector, exploiting his own people. But Jesus transformed him by the power of his love, and Zacchaeus became the most generous man in Jericho. When the good king rules, it changes everything.
Secondly, Messiah is the crucified king.
You know, if you were a bird flying over a traditional church, you might notice that it's built in the shape of a cross.
And many Christians wear the cross as a piece of jewelry. This symbol, originally of brutal execution, has become the logo of Christianity, because the cross is the ultimate display of God's love.
Jesus spent the final week of his life in and around Jerusalem. We call it Holy Week. And there the religious leaders became jealous of Jesus' popularity, and they plotted to kill him. Jesus knew it was coming. He even knew his own follower Judas would betray him, but he let it happen. Why? Well, a deeper and more mysterious plotline was unfolding. By suffering brutal crucifixion, Jesus absorbed into himself all our evil, rejection, selfishness, and pain. The death of the Messiah was not a tragic end, but a heroic act of selfless love. Jesus died in our place, for our sin, so that we could be forgiven and transformed. Now remember this as you imagine the Roman soldiers beating him, the crowd mocking him, nails smashed through his wrists and ankles. If you want to know how much God loves you, look no further. As an old hymn puts it, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, and my all.
And finally, Messiah is the risen King.
By Friday evening, Jesus was dead and buried, another victim of the tragic reign of death. But something dramatic unfolded over the course of the weekend. So by Monday morning, the world was not the same place anymore. The resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday is the defining moment in world history. The whole Bible is shaped like an hourglass. It funnels down to this moment. When the Messiah was crucified, thick darkness descended. But the resurrection of Jesus is a cosmic sunrise over our entire human story. Now, the specific claim of resurrection is not that Jesus briefly flatlined on the ECG monitor before being resuscitated. No, he was not revived from death. He broke through it. He triumphed over it. And now he reigns on the other side. To prove this, Jesus physically appeared to his disciples on several occasions. Even doubting Thomas got to touch him. Then Jesus said to Thomas, "Reach out and put your hand in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Now, isn't that interesting? The wounds of Jesus' crucifixion remain visible even after his resurrection. But now, these scars tell the story of God's love. There's an old Japanese art of mending broken pottery called kintsugi. The name means golden joinery, and the process involves using a resin mixed with gold to reassemble broken pieces. The result is a pot or vase that is now more valuable than the original. The risen Jesus is the master of kintsugi. His sacrificial love is the golden resin that can take what's broken and turn it into something beautiful, more valuable than it was before. So let's not hide our brokenness from Jesus. When we give our lives to him, the golden resin of his love transforms us.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life.
Let us now respond by affirming our faith together. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
I lost my own dad when I was 8 years old. It was quite serious circumstances. He was murdered. Throughout my early teens and 20s, that affected my behaviour. I got into all sorts of trouble, a lot of trouble. I was quite an angry kid, quite a violent kid. And, you know, I didn't really sort of talk. I would, you know, my fist did more talking than my mouth. And then I met Jenny, who is my lovely wife, and I met her dad for the first time when I was about 29 years old. And he was a bedrock in terms of my spiritual development. He was somebody who listened to me intently, took me seriously, and that spiritual element that he brought changed my life, changed my outlook, changed everything. You know, I actually was one of the pallbearers at his funeral. It was probably one of the hardest days of my life. The sense of loss I felt was quite profound. I didn't realise it would affect me that badly, but it did. when I finally sort of accepted Jesus into my life and starting to go through the Bible, it was just mind blown by some of the truths in it, or some of the claims that were made, some of the things and the way God described himself. And I'm like, well, you did all that for me. Your son died for me. Didn't make any sense to me. Why would you die for me? You know, you see the state of my life, you know? And at the time, you know, there was, you know, alcohol, all the rest. It was all there. It was all the things that you could possibly do to run yourself off the road. But God came in and through his word, which was just massive, just started to really start to, I started to put stuff together. When I finally realized that God is my father, that it changed everything. It changed how I focused. It changed how I saw situations, because I knew I wasn't alone. Sometimes in this world, you go through things and you think you're on your own. You could be in a whole room full of people and feel like you're on your own, but you realize that God's your father. So at no point are you alone. And that was a game changer. That's the most profound truth I can say after what maybe 20 years as a Christian coming up. He's with me.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent your one and only Son, so that all who believe in him may have eternal life. Thank you that he became incarnate, so that he could be among us. Thank you that he showed us your character and how much you love us. Jesus, we thank you for showing us the way. We thank you for saving us. We thank you for loving us, no matter what we have done or who we are. We thank you that you bring healing, forgiveness, and life in all its fullness. We ask for your forgiveness when we have not listened to you, when we have not acknowledged you or have forgotten you. We ask that you will take center stage in our lives again, that we would become more like you as we follow you. Lord, we thank you that you conquered death, that love wins, that you bring hope, that you bring everlasting life. Lord, we ask that our love for you may be renewed, that our hunger for you may be rekindled, that our thirst for you may be felt again, so that we may drink from the water of life. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Let's now share in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
And now, our closing prayer. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And so go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.